Jungle Deep. The podcast that explores the tropical lifestyle. Hello and welcome to the podcast, Jungle Deep. This is your host, Dr. Jones. We are on safari, and I'm here with you to learn, to have fun, and to explore the jungle. Let's explore volunteer tourism in the tropical rainforest. For those that don't know, that's when you volunteer to work for free on your vacation for some nonprofit in a faraway, dangerous corner of a jungle in the middle of nowhere. Why would you do that? Just a couple of weeks ago, we heard the president of Conservation International, a highly educated family man and world traveler, advise us to get out and travel to see the rainforest for ourselves, so that we can experience firsthand what is at stake with the destruction of the tropical rainforest. So what would that be like? What would it be like for you to step outside of your normal day-to-day life and actually book a flight to some foreign country to help an environmental conservation effort in the jungle? Today we are going to have a conversation with a young man, 24 years old, who has done it. Not once, but four times already. We are going to meet jungle adventurer and documentary filmmaker Adam Spencer, who has traveled to the South American tropics, trips that include the Galapagos Islands, Peru, Bolivia, Chile, and Costa Rica. He is passionate about conservation and volunteering to help promote nonprofit organizations. Adam is educated in biology, journalism, and Spanish. He recently married his longtime friend and sweetheart and fellow traveler, Shay Lynn. Adam currently has the production of a film underway about the volunteer tourism experience called Volunteer Traveler, Costa Rica. Our conversation begins now. Hello, Adam. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, Ken. Nice to hear from you.
Did I get the name of that film right, Volunteer Traveler?
Yeah, I'm working on a series of films called Volunteer Traveler, and this one in specific is called Volunteer Traveler, Costa Rica.
Ah, okay. Very good. Well, I would like you to describe for us the first time you went to help a nonprofit group in the jungle. What happened to make you start thinking about doing such a thing?
Yeah, my first experience, you know, working in these tropical locations happened to be the Galapagos Islands, and I just felt incredibly lucky to be able to be at this such a unique ecosystem. And I was in college, and I was studying documentary film, and I'd always been interested in wildlife film. And it's actually hard to find internships that have practical field experience in film. And this organization came up. It's called Experiential Learning International Abroad. And they had this film internship with the Galapagos Islands. So, you know, it just immediately piqued my interest of having this travel aspect to it, studying Spanish, and being able to work with wildlife in a unique place in the world. So that just really jumped out at me.
Well, I guess so. So it was a sponsorship or an internship, I should say, having to do with filmmaking.
Yeah.
That's got to be kind of unusual. Yeah. I can imagine why you might grab that. Plus, everybody's heard about the Galapagos Islands. I think most people I talk to would love to go and see them firsthand. Can you tell us a little bit about the islands? Are they what you'd call a tropical environment?
Definitely. And, you know, everyone's heard of the Galapagos, but people have no idea what's happened in the last 150 years since they've heard that Darwin went there. You know, going to this island 600 miles off the coast of Ecuador, it's a very developed place. There's thousands of people living on these islands, and they're catering to a tourism industry that tops 400,000 people a year.
400,000?
400,000 people a year,
that's
yeah.
That's a lot of people.
And so you get off the plane, and you have to jump on a boat, and then jump on a bus, and then jump on a boat. But it finally takes you to this city that's about 25,000 people called Puerto Ayora. It's just really interesting that there's still marine iguanas and pelicans and sea lions living on the streets here. And it's almost like they're at odds with the people who now have cars on the island, electricity, some industrialism there. But I was lucky because I got to avoid all of that and live on Isabella Island, which only has 1,000 people. And there's still sand roads. There's birds flying overhead all day long, and it's just an entire island based as a beach community. And so here I come as a, you know, college junior looking to do this internship and just really hit the jackpot living on the beach, living with some other volunteers, staying with a host family. And the national park that I worked for didn't really know what to do with me. So they basically said, well, why don't you come film and photograph to everything that we are doing? Eventually, I had a pretty good body of evidence to make a documentary about the development caused by tourism and the damage to the environment that was happening from this new transition.
So is Isabella open to the public, or is it a, like a protected off-limits park?
It is. There, 97% of the Galapagos Islands are managed by the Galapagos National Park and are off-limits to the public.
Wow.
But the islands of Santa Cruz, which is the main island that the tourism is funneled through, that's usually where people get to, and then they take a cruise ship. With this new tourism industry coming, only 6% of the tourism's economy stays with the islanders. So most of it's the airlines and then the cruise lines. And a lot of the hotels, even when people do stay on the island, are managed from the main continent in Ecuador or in other countries. And so that's kind of a problem, is you have this huge influx of tourism that want, you know, it's a luxury place, it's expensive to get to. These are ecotourists, birders, people with expensive camera equipment that want to have the lifetime experience on the Galapagos. But at the same time, there are these kind of poor islands that are having to deal with all of this without getting to keep the money there. So it's a really interesting paradox between, you know, they need to encourage tourism so that they can raise money to be able to afford to protect their environment from the tourism that they're needing the money from.
Catch 22.
Yeah.
I imagine there's a lot of places that kind of wrestle with that, trying to find a balance and to want to encourage ecotourism to help protect their environment, and yet don't want so much that it starts to fight against them. So that's a real problem with Galapagos. I guess they're so well known. I guess they do they have limits? Are there any restrictions on how many people can go in a period of time?
Yeah, that's, you know, that's something a lot of people approach. But it's also, you know, it's an economic force, and it's one of Ecuador's main economic attractions. Is you know, it's their jewel of conservation. They're entirely proud of it, and they are working really hard, and they have been. You know, making a lot of progress in a lot of areas. You know, I don't want to get that idea that it's just going completely downhill. I'd go there the sooner the better to see it in its better state. It's going to be there and it's going to survive.
Well, I'm getting ahead of myself with these questions a little bit. I have a tendency to do that. But I wanted to first ask, now this was your first time taking such a trip. What group was it that you volunteered to help?
Experiential Learning International Abroad set up this internship. And through the internship, they got me a position with the Galapagos National Park.
And how did you choose them? How did you know about them?
Yeah, like I said, I was searching for online. I was searching online for internships. I came across, you know, well, I want to work in this wildlife film industry. So do I want to go do an in-office, you know, pushing paper kind of thing, getting coffee, or do I want to go out there and actually do it? And yeah,
so you found them on the internet.
Yeah, you my girlfriend at the time.
Googling internships,
volunteer film internships.
In the tropics or just for
any
nonprofit?
Yeah, it was just, basically a volunteer film internship. And it just happened to be a wildlife position as well. So.
And in Galapagos, of all wonderful places, that sounds like quite a great opportunity came your way there. The position was to do some filming for them. How long were you there?
I was there for 3 months.
Wow, that's quite a while.
Yeah.
Long enough to really get a feel for the place, huh?
Yeah, long enough to even living in paradise get a little bit of island fever. But, it was an incredible time to be there and to really kind of get a rapport with the community. Like I said, it's sand roads. Everyone knows everyone because it's a small town. And so I was suddenly the island journalist.
Uh-huh.
And I got to interview different people around the island about what they thought of development and, what they thought their community could do to work together to fix those problems.
And you were shooting video at this time, too?
Yeah, I was shooting video. I had a DVD cam that I got for high school graduation. So, I was just totally amateur, went with my own equipment. I didn't even have lighting kit or a way to record audio, just with a little cheap camcorder and,
you gotta start
and
somewhere.
A camera as well. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
What did you do to prepare for the trip?
I didn't. Actually, I had one of my professors at the University of Oregon had just written a book about the Galapagos Islands. Her name is Carol Ann Bassett, and it's a National Geographic book called Galapagos at the Crossroads. And so I was reading her book, and I had a couple of classes with her, and then I found this internship. And so she was really encouraging to say, this is an amazing place to be an environmental journalist, an amazing place to get wildlife film and videography. And so she was really supportive in saying, yeah, just go here, go do this. It's a completely new place. And so that was really neat to have such a close connection with somebody who knew the island so well.
Yeah, that must have helped build your confidence.
Yeah.
What did you figure the trip cost you?
The internship position, so to the coordinating and the living expenses for the 12 weeks was $2,200. So $2,000 to live on this island for 3 months and another probably $500 to $600 for traveling expenses and some tours and things that I did. So we're looking at about under $4,000 for a 3 month trip and an incredible internship experience.
Yeah. Well, that sounds like a bargain, really.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And it's, volunteer travel is just so much cheaper than living in these luxury lodges for two nights. And, people open up their homes to help you because they're so happy that you're helping them.
What was it like when you arrived on the first Galapagos Island? Can you kind of take us back to that moment? You came by boat?
Yeah, so I flew from Ecuador to the airport is on the island called Baltra, and it used to be a United States Air Force base. And then you fly from Ecuador, take a bus to a ferry to get to the other island, then take a bus to the main city on that island, and then I arrived to take the boat from Santa Cruz to Isabella Island, and it was completely full, and I had already bought my ticket for this boat. And so what they did actually is they had me walk on the outside of the boat on about a 2-inch wide railing with all my gear, and then they shoved me into the luggage bin area, basically. And then it's just this...
So your adventure started early.
Yeah, yeah. It was about a 4-hour long boat ride in this gas fumed in... luggage bin, just trying to surf the jumpy waters. So
I was going to ask you, what was it like, what did it smell like, what did it feel like?
Yeah, I felt like a stowaway rat. Yeah,
diesel fumes and smoke.
But but then once I got out of this boat and above water, it was gorgeous. So we went into this there's a lot of mangroves there in the Galapagos Islands. And so I got my first view of my new home as this mangrove lagoon with white sand beaches, beautiful sun, aquamarine water, and all these pelicans, albatross, and, just really got a sense of I'm living on an island for the summer. This is going to be amazing.
Wow, that's great. What did you hope you would be doing during your stay there, and did it turn out like you expected?
Initially, I hoped to make a documentary about the tourism and development. My initial idea was to kind of make the documentary film version of my professor's book. But, her book was a lot about her personal experience as well. So basically taking those issues and making a film version of it specific to Isabella Island. The National Park didn't know necessarily what to do with me. They had a communications manager who, she was doing her reports and things like that, but they hadn't worked in film or photography. So I actually got there and they said, well, the park director's gone, so why don't you just work at the giant tortoise breeding center? So I spent the first week just raking up giant tortoise poop and wondering, like, well, well, this is great and all, but I came here to do some film work. I'm not just a rake. So, I mean, it was very zen, you know, raking circles around these very stoic tortoises that are iconic.
But so not what you were expecting.
Right, yeah.
So they had advertised for a film intern, but there was really no one for you to intern with.
Right. The position was a standing position with the volunteer organization. So then once they had somebody apply, then they said, okay, well, this person's coming, you know, get ready for it. And there's a little bit of juggling to get the paperwork together and everything. But once the park director was there, then they said, okay, well, here's our intern. We're going to have him take some videos and some photography. And it was actually the 50th anniversary of the Galapagos National Park. So by the end of my time there, I put together a short film for them that kind of showed their projects and was kind of a celebratory film to say, this is what we do on the island. And they celebrated all their workers and their projects and things like that. And meanwhile, I was using the video from their projects and conducting my own interviews with the mayor, with environmental lawyers, with naturalist guides and business owners to talk about how their businesses or welfare or environment was changing from the development and tourism. And so I put together a documentary about kind of a précis of Isabella Island and what it's struggling with right now.
And you were able to get that done while you were there?
Yeah, I got all the footage collected and interviews done and then took it home and worked on it for about another year, actually, as my thesis piece for my university.
I see. So when you arrived, did you feel welcomed by the people there?
Oh, yeah. It's a very friendly place. There's a lot of surfers there. There's a lot of other volunteers working on different projects, like working at the Tortoise Breeding Center or teaching English in some of the schools. And so there's a quite a formidable expat community for such a small island. You know, it's a small town, so there's, you know, two bars. People just go to the same bars every night, and you just go have a beer on the beach and then go home and, you know, walk in your flip-flops everywhere. So,
What about the land itself? Most of the shots I've seen of the Galapagos have been shoreline shots, but is there some tropical vegetation on the islands, or is it more arid than that?
Yeah, it's primarily arid. It's a volcanic island. And so there's a lot of lava flow that's just open. But there's also, once you get to a certain elevation, there's tropical forests there. And they have a kind of a wetlands area as well. The beaches have white sand or the coast is lava. And there's also a lot of mangroves. What's interesting is there's, with the colonization of the islands, there's been a lot of introduced plants that are invasively spreading throughout these forested areas. There's a lot of vines, like blackberry is a big problem, and guava as well is a problem. And so there's five volcanoes on Isabel Island, and the main one, the largest one, is called Sierra Negra, and that has a whole forest rim around the volcano at a certain elevation.
Mm-hmm. And you said five volcanoes?
Yeah, five volcanoes.
Wow. Well, what was the most unpleasant aspect of your trip?
Yeah, that's a tough question. There's times where I didn't really get along with my host family too well. And looking back is just some really silly things. There's an agreement to have dinner every day and things like that. And she was actually quite a jokester, and I really appreciate it now. And I've actually since visited, and we have a great relationship. But I think I kind of got to this point where I didn't feel like I was making much of a difference. You know, I think the volunteer ideal is that you go and, you know, it's a little bit of a white savior instinct almost, that you're like celebrating. You know, you think of like what the Peace Corps was in the 60s when it first started and that kind of idyllic view. But I think the reality is you do what you can and you're living there in a part of the community and just to listen to people. And so I really learned that, you know, it really wasn't about me and that it's about what I could do. And if it wasn't as much as I thought I could do, that I'm still there trying to help.
Because it's not all under your control.
Yeah, I was dependent on a lot of generosity, on, you know, what I could accomplish, if people would allow me to even work. There's a bit of tricky setting up with permission to film and things like that. So, and you know, I had never done this before. I'd never made a documentary before. I had never lived in a Spanish-speaking country before. So it was just a wonderful growing experience in those senses. And I'm really happy with how it turned out. And it just has inspired me to keep on going and volunteering.
Well, I guess so, because you did go on to make several other trips. What was the best aspect of the time you spent there? What are your best memories?
Some of my best memories are working with this environmental education group. So they took the teenagers from the island to go monitor sea turtles. You know, there's that the scene of when sea turtles pop up from the sand and they have to run to the beach before the seagulls get them, you know, and get into the ocean. So I was hiking with them, and we were in this protected area where tourists can't go. And it's actually my first week there that they said, well, we're going to go camping. I hadn't really gotten a control of understanding everything yet. And so it wasn't until we were out at night with flashlights that I understood that we were actually going to go see sea turtles migrate to the ocean. And that's actually one of my life goals to see. So I was really excited, and I spent all day, you know, kind of goofing around with these kids and being the gringo guy who's trying to interview them as well. And it was just a really cool experience to really become a part of the community quick on this camping trip.
You are listening to
Jungle Deep, Deep, Deep.
Hello, this is Dr. Jones. I believe the better you get to know the jungle's wonderful creatures, the more you will care about them. And as you care about them, you'll want to join with me in efforts to protect them and save them from extinction. I want to draw your attention to the Jungle Deep website and the ways I am promoting tropical rainforest education and conservation. In addition to the awesome expert guests and regular reports from our wonderful field correspondents on the podcast, I am building a website with resources to help everyone, especially students, find helpful and motivating information. One example is the new Wildlife Theater, which will contain a collection of photos and videos of exotic animals from the jungles around the world. Top-notch zoos and other conservation groups are contributing content to the Jungle Deep Wildlife Theater. You will find the Jungle Deep website by going to www.jungledeep.com. It couldn't be easier. Check the Jungle Deep website often, because it is growing every week.
This is David Dutoy. I'm the Tarzan from Africa, and I bathe my elephant while I'm listening to Jungle Deep podcast.
My name is Ali. I run Purses for Primates, and I sort my purses while listening to Jungle Deep.
Hi, I'm Al Bowl, film producer of Tarzan, Lord of Louisiana Jungle, and I clean my lenses while listening to Jungle Deep.
Jungle Deep, Deep, Deep.
Hello, this is Dr. Jones. We don't just talk about tigers and toucans, elephants and orangutans on Jungle Deep. Because it is his 100-year centennial anniversary, we are also talking about the Lord of the Jungle, Tarzan. Authors, animators, actors, filmmakers, and even Tarzan himself are guests on our show. You have heard nothing like it. Listen to the podcast, Jungle Deep.
Jungle Deep, Deep, Deep.
Jungle Deep is a one-of-a-kind podcast that promotes conservation in a most entertaining way. If you want me to make more Jungle Deep episodes, let me know by making a donation to this environmental education podcast. If you would like, for a donation of $20 or more, I'll be happy to make a shout-out on the show. That's a short message about your favorite wildlife or conservation organization. You may send any amount by check mailed to me, the producer, Ken Jones, at P.O. Box 61, Murphy's, M-U-R-P-H-Y-S, California, 95247. You know, most people don't make a donation and just listen to the podcast for free. That makes your donation all the more important. The core message of Jungle Deep is that we need more people to participate in conservation. It's not enough to love nature. These days, caring about the environment absolutely requires action. Your action in support of this show will be used to grow Jungle Deep and to help me reach more people with our conservation message. Thank you. Now, more of
Jungle Deep, Deep, Deep.
And who has responsibility for these islands?
Ecuador is, they're Ecuadorian territories. I mean, they're a state, I believe, in Ecuador, a province, actually.
Do you think they're doing an adequate job of managing this growth?
You know, they're not really doing it right. There's a lot of conflicting interest in the park, park service as well. The Galapagos National Park has had a lot of internal turnover, a lot of kind of shady deals going on. Like there's, they had a woman park director for a few months and she was actually shot and had to resign. There's a lot of controversy going on between these industries trying to take control of this economic boom and the actual environmentalists trying to protect it all.
I imagine some of those environmentalists are very frustrated.
Yeah, you know, they're really, Ecuador in general is so proud of the Galapagos Islands, but there's a lot of problems that they're just trying to sweep under the rug to keep getting people to come.
Hmm. Well, let's change gears for a minute, at least a little bit, and let me ask you why you are dedicated to promoting volunteer tourism.
Volunteer tourism to me is just such an amazing opportunity to not only go and develop your career and to meet new people and interesting experiences, but you just learn so much about yourself. You put yourself into challenging positions. You know, you have to figure things out and figure out a new language and a new culture. And I just can't think of a better way to have yourself go through some personal growth than to give yourself and give service, learn what type of person you are from that.
But why volunteer tourism? Now, see, a lot of our listeners, I'm sure most of us, maybe have never been to a tropical country anywhere in the world and might like to make such a trip, but why would we get involved in volunteer tourism?
Well, even beyond just tourism, there's the economic aspect that you are staying for free often. Some places you'll have a stipend. For instance, we were staying at a 5-star nature resort in Manu, Peru, and it's one of the most pristine and biodiverse regions of the world. And as
you're a volunteer with some nonprofit there and they put you up in a 5-star hotel, is that what you're saying?
Well, it's a lodge, and it's an ecotourism lodge that has supreme quality. Hot water showers, you know, there's bars, there's wonderful food, and it's a remote.
Now that sounds like a great deal. Now, did you know about that ahead of time, or was that a bit of a surprise?
We didn't know that the quality of the lodge. We knew we'd stay at the lodge, but when we get there, you know, we have to pay $15 a day for food and lodging, which is cheaper than we could live back at home. So we're traveling for cheaper than normal.
Okay,
costs.
So that's one thing. It can save you quite a bit of money. You can stay cheaply. In some cases, even for free, in exchange for the time that you spend. Do you find that the commitment that your organization is expecting from you, is it fairly flexible or lax or stringent? How have you found that to be?
It can really vary. In most of the cases, especially as a filmmaker, you know, it's so dependent on your own initiative to accomplish something, you know, that you'll go with an organization and they won't know anything about film. You know, they don't have any resources for you. So it's all a matter of what can I do while I'm here? What do I want to do? And so that's as much as involvement as you can.
Of course, that wouldn't be the case for the average tourist.
I'd say, you know, the average volunteer will probably be going to work with English or to do some sort of child care, child development. And in my experience, a lot of those positions are still a limited hourly kind of thing every day. You know, like they'll have, okay, well, we need to take care of kids during their lunchtime or something like that, or teach an English class for 1 hour a day. And it just completely varies on the situation and the degree at which this volunteer organization wants qualified volunteers and how much they'll respect their volunteers. But for the most part, it's, you know, it's encouraging their experience. So they're going to want to make it enjoyable for you. They're going to want to make you say it was wonderful and send their friends and tell everybody to come.
That's a good point. So they really make an effort for you to feel valued and welcome.
Right. Yeah.
I imagine in most cases you can find out ahead of time what it is they're expecting or wanting you to do. I mean, you actually sign up for some particular kind of job, right?
Yeah, and I'd imagine once you get there, for the most cases, I think volunteers find out that they are wishing they could do more than what their position entails. So that's just a matter of while you're there, you know, you're there, so why not meet people? Why not see where else you could be used? Why not see how else you can help out?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, so it's an inexpensive way to see other countries and to get to see natural environments as well as meet indigenous people and do some good in the world.
Yeah, and you'll see those places in much more depth than you would be able to as a tourist on a two-day trip to this place. And a two-day trip to this place, you'll have, you know, at least a week or 2 weeks in a certain place to get to know it, to feel it, to live there, and to really experience it than just to get enough time to take the photos and leave.
And for me personally, I would just think that would be probably one of the greatest values of doing it this way, of being a volunteer tourist, is that you're really gonna get to know what it's like there. You're not just zooming through taking a bunch of photographs on, you know, like most people do on a trip.
Right. Yeah.
It's really a very different experience, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a life experience, not just a tourism experience.
How are you going to promote? I know this is something you care about. It's mentioned on your websites, and you currently have a film, which we're going to talk about in just a second. How else do you expect to promote volunteer tourism? And have you found any sponsors for this kind of effort? Is there an industry association of volunteer tourism?
Yeah, there's a lot of kind of independent databases for finding these volunteer opportunities. I haven't necessarily found, you know, a sponsorship program to say, like, hey, I'm going to go out there on the ground, and if you can pay my bills, you know, I'll keep doing this, that's the point I'd love to get to is...
Well, yeah, they probably benefit by having a spokesperson,
right.
Especially someone that's capable of producing film media for it as well. But I imagine it's, well, not an infant industry, but a small industry and not a very formal one, probably rather informal.
You know, the few that I've worked with, I'd say it's kind of informal. It's a bunch of passionate people putting together some sort of volunteer program to get something done. You know, I worked with one Sustainable Bolivia in Bolivia, and the guy went there and his volunteer position fell through. So he just started his own organization, and now they get 300 volunteers a year, and they're working so that it'll be free for volunteers to stay by their grants. You know, it's for me, promoting these films using social media, putting it on YouTube, trying to post to similar industry desires. Like, I've worked with solar energy, and I've worked with the religious groups, so trying to promote to like-minded religious groups. And it's a struggle, you know. There's to start out as a volunteer with no resources, and then to try to advertise without any resources, to try to make money. It's a very difficult uphill battle. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a matter of depending on word of mouth and people being interested.
But the internet does help us with that a bit.
Yeah, you know, it's and the whole...
In fact, you're using the internet right now to help promote this film. So would you mind telling us about your film and how you're using the internet to promote?
The Volunteer Traveler Costa Rica is really my first full-length, well-thought-out process in this volunteer travel episodes that I've been doing. Primarily, I've gone and worked on these projects and tried to film myself doing it, or, you know, try to get sort of an idea of what I'm going through. But this is actually not based on me. It's based on my wife and her volunteer work in Costa Rica. And so what she was doing down there as a wildlife technician was searching for nests for a certain bird that is going endangered of extinction because of habitat fragmentation. They're trying to get a baseline study to see the difference of predatory rates on these birds in fragmented habitat versus contiguous habitat. So basically, I went as a filmmaker and followed her every day, searching in the bush, looking out for snakes and bullet ants and all these other dangerous things you can get in the jungle, while she looked for nests and lived with people who are also working on the project and got to explore different parts of Costa Rica.
And is it as beautiful as we hear about?
It is beautiful. It is a beautiful place. And one of the shameful things about the film is that here's Costa Rica. It is this wonderful place, but there's deforestation there. And it's known as the ecological, you know, light at the hill as far as Latin American conservation goes, but it still has its own problems. I think it's going to be kind of unpopular to say, but you know, this film is about looking into those problems and showing the work of volunteers and scientists and conservationists to study the effects of deforestation on, you know, a limited landscape.
Mm-hmm. So not all is well in Costa Rica?
For the most part, definitely yes. They've been recently voted the happiest country in the world. The people there are amazing. They live in paradise. There's just still those same problems with development and industry that we have everywhere else in the world. It's just a matter of knowing about it and you know, making a hubbub about it.
And how are you promoting this film?
So I'm promoting this film with a Kickstarter campaign. Kickstarter is a crowdfunding website where people, primarily of the arts, put up together a project that they're trying to get funded. And so right now I've gone and filmed, and I've basically spent my own money to fly down there to get the camera equipment that I've needed. And now I'm trying to get the money to purchase music rights and to distribute the film. It's dependent on, you know, people watching a little video about the project and hoping that it succeeds and donating a little money. And the idea that, you know, if 10 people give $10, you know, 100 people give $10, that you can put together a project like that.
And how can someone find out more about your film on Kickstarter? Where can they go?
Yeah, if you go to Kickstarter.com and search Volunteer Traveler Costa Rica, my project will come up, and it'll have a video that kind of talks about what I've done as a volunteer and why it's important to get this message out there. And you can also visit my website at adamspencerphotography.com.
So that's Kickstarter.com, and search for Volunteer Traveler Costa Rica. Your page should come up where they can learn about your campaign and contribute, be a part of your support system in the production of these videos. For more information about your activities, you're quite a photographer. You have some beautiful photographs I've enjoyed already, and background information on your experiences and such.
Thank you.
That's at your personal website, Adam Spence Photography.
Adam Spencer, S-P-E-N-C-E-R.
Spencer, right. Photography.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's terrific. Do you maintain a Facebook page, or do you tweet?
Yeah. I'm at Spencer-Adam on Twitter, and Adam Spencer Photography on Facebook as well.
Great. Well, we'll certainly include those on our show notes page for this episode. Is there anyone, do you think volunteer tourism works for most people, or are there some types of people that you think maybe shouldn't consider volunteer tourism?
You know, there's definitely the person who gets out there and then expects a lot more, or, you know, doesn't like to get dirty or wants to stay in a 5-star hotel. But I also think that that's the perfect person to go do it, because that's shaking up their world a little bit. You know, it's putting them out of their comfort zone and making them realize that that's how most of the world lives. I mean, if you go as a volunteer traveler and stay in a hostel, it's still going to be nicer than most people will have in their daily lives. So, you know, I think it's important for almost everybody to really see the thriftier side of living, and especially living in other countries and cultures. You know, it's a great opportunity for young people who are in college and looking for career experience, who are looking for an internship, who are looking to travel and learn a language. But it's also great for people who are ready to take a break from their 20 years of career experience and want to contribute to the world in another way. They're actually going to have probably the biggest impact to use their experience and knowledge to help developing countries.
Well, I think you brought up some terrific points here, and I really appreciate, I don't know where this time went already, but I appreciate the time that you've spent with us and giving us an inside look on what volunteer travel is about and what it's like. You make it sound pretty appealing. It may be a great way for many people to go and truly experience the tropical rainforest.
Yeah, I really hope so. It's so amazing, and just the experiences you'll have will last a lifetime. And, you know, you'll still get to take those photos, you'll still get to say I was there and see those animals, but you also remember your trip as an adventure and not just as a trip.
There you go. Well said. And I encourage all of our listeners to check out your new film, starting at the Kickstarter.com site, Volunteer Traveler Costa Rica, and keep tabs on you and your productions, and we'll continue to learn more about volunteer travel from Adam Spencer. Thanks, Adam, very much for being with us today.
Yeah, thanks so much, Ken. It's been a pleasure.
Bye-bye now.
Yeah, take care.
Environmental education, wildlife preservation, tropical rainforest conservation, all wrapped up in fun, juicy, delicious American jungle culture of the past and present. Be sure to share Jungle Deep Podcast with your friends and coworkers. The show is my creation and at my personal expense. It is not currently subsidized by any business or organization, but I am ready to change that, so contact me if you would like to reach our audience with your advertising message. Audience growth is especially important for Jungle Deep to succeed and prosper, so share the show. You can see beautiful photos and learn more about Jungle Deep at our website, jungledeep.com. You gotta check it out. Where else can you go for this kind of fun? Our show notes pages have valuable links for you. I invite you to email me at ken@jungledeep.com or follow me on Twitter. Search for Jungle Deep or KenJones56, all one word. I would love to hear your ideas for the show. Well, the show's over for today, so it's time to refill my Mai Tai, mount my elephant, and head back into the jungle.